You're watching The Breakfast Club.
It's Power 105.1. It's The Breakfast Club. Good morning. We got a special guest in the building this morning.
No. You say special guest all the time. We got something different. Special, legendary,
okay.
You know, iconic,
okay.
You know, all that.
You got to keep going then.
Sir Carter from Brooklyn.
All right.
Young Hov.
Yeah.
Jay-Z,
ladies and gentlemen.
Yes, sir.
Good morning, sir.
What's happening?
Welcome.
We were taking bets on how you were going to arrive. Was it going to be a chariot, white horse? Were you going to float in like Prince? Like,
Or were you going to arrive at all?
I was on Pekka's back.
Pekka's back again. Well, welcome.
Thank you. This is very hard to navigate.
No matter what happens in here, just don't get Charlamagne fired. There was rumors that you got Charlamagne fired one time. We just don't want to fight.
Oh, gosh. Uh-oh.
Listen, my last name is Pinkett Smith Winfrey Knowles Carter, okay?
Mm-hmm.
I'm cool over here.
All right, just making sure. Right. Just making sure. Well, congratulations
on
that.
I wanted them to get you a throne, too.
Yeah.
But they weren't sure if you were coming. I was like, yo, we can't have Jay sit in this chair. But then he was like, yo, he's from Marcy. He sat on stage coming
up. I could take it back for how long we here? A couple hours.
I guess we'll see.
Well, congratulations on the album. The album's in stores right now.
Yes, and you were on Twitter last night. That was incredible. A lot of people didn't believe that was you.
That was amazing. I had a great time. That's like addictive. I can't be on Twitter. It's like weed.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I like it, but too much of that is too... It's not good for me.
There's no way you could see everybody's questions either. I'm sure some people were like, oh, you didn't answer my question.
Yeah, I mean, it's impossible.
Mm-hmm. Do you know who people are? Like, some of the people that you were answering, I was like, oh, I know who that person is. Or were you just randomly...
No, I didn't know anyone. I knew one person. I knew G-Spin. He was
G-Spin.
So you actually do know G-Spin. We're taking bets on that, too.
We didn't think you knew G-Spin either.
We were taking bets on that one, too. Does G really know Jay?
We didn't think so.
Yeah, I know G-Spin. He's messing with my Cowboys. That's the only person I knew. I ain't really know anybody else.
Now, I'm a Cowboy fanatic, too. They always give me flack because they say I'm from South Carolina, so I shouldn't root from the Cowboys. How do you do it being from New York? And, you know, you got the Giants and the Jets. How can you be a Cowboys fan in this city?
I grew up, my pop is really my pop for, you know.
He grew up in that era
of those guys who, you know, wanted that whole Cowboy lifestyle. It was, all those guys was on coke and,
my pops was definitely on coke.
The chair.
Well, it's true.
Oh, I bet your dad didn't.
I got the whole thing pegged. I could give you the whole profile. Did he have an afro?
He absolutely had an afro. Absolutely.
But I bet your dad didn't tase somebody at the Cowboys Jets game like Charlamagne's dad did.
That was my father.
He's a real fanatic.
He tased somebody at the game. Remember last year,
first game Cowboys Jets at MetLife Stadium.
Like in this era?
Yes.
Last year.
From South Carolina, he didn't know. He tased his illegal.
He got arrested.
He let him in with it. He got into a fight with some Jets fans.
He's serious.
He's a Cowboys guy.
You
die hard over here.
I definitely wouldn't have put that on the profile, but that type of fan, and you know, it's my pop's team, so I couldn't, like, you know, I had to watch it growing up.
It's gonna be tough this year. I don't know if you guys are gonna make the playoffs this year.
All right, man.
Them Giants looking good. I'm just saying, them Giants looking good. We just signed Victor Cruz for about another 6 years.
If the Jets are winning next season, he's a Jets fan. Yeah. Giants start winning, he roots for the Giants. He's confused.
It's early in the morning for that, bro.
Now, I was shocked at one thing on Twitter when you said that Magna Carta Holy Grail you thought was fighting for fourth place as far as best albums. Because I think every time you put out an album, you think, okay, this is my best album to date. And that was very honest of you to say that, but do you really believe that? It's only fourth place?
I mean, only fourth place, but I mean, fighting for that three, you gotta fight Reasonable Doubt, Blueprint, and the Black Album. That's just hard.
Is that the order you put it in that order? Reasonable Doubt first?
Reasonable Doubt, it's the first album I made because, you know, that's the joint I took my whole life to make. Reasonable Doubt, then Blueprint, then the Black Album. But sometimes I switch the Blueprint to Black Album. Don't tell nobody.
Is it hard though? Because you're competing against yourself. Like, you're competing against classics. Like, you know, you can't compare to me. You can't compare, you know, Holy Grail to Reasonable Doubt or the Blueprint, because it was different times in your life.
True. That's part of the reason why I put it forth. It's very difficult to, like, recreate those times. Those times was like, I mean, obviously, you can't bring those times back. But, you know, just for it to be so high says what I think about it.
What's the inspiration?
It's new anyway, I might not think that way in 2 weeks.
Yeah.
What's the inspiration? Because I know you used to say Big was inspired you to spit Nas, but do you get inspired by artists now?
The era I grew up in is like Biggie, Nas, you know, Tupac. It's very difficult to compare to those guys. You know, it just is, and So I'm inspired by my previous work.
Mm-hmm.
So that's I have to measure myself against that. And
like this, do you ever hear a record now that you'd be like, you know what, I'm going in the lab, or is it just seems like it's ABC 1, 2, 3? Because a lot of the music to me, I know it makes you sound like an old head, make me sound like an old head, but it just don't sound the same. It don't feel the same.
Nah, it's good music. It's just hard. It's just you gotta mind for it. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, before it was, I felt there was, you know, an abundance of it. But that's what happened, you know, when anything's successful. Like, people were rapping because they loved the rap. Mm-hmm. And then it became this, you know, huge business, this multi-billion-dollar business. So people that didn't even care to rap was like, I'm going to figure out how to get some money in this. So mm-hmm. you had people who could rap a little bit and saw it as a hustle. Then you had guys, CEOs, rapping. You know, this is no disrespect to anyone, mm-hmm. just to be clear. You had people rapping like, yo, you should rap. Like, Big Toe Puff, you should rap.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Puff wasn't a rapper, mm-hmm. you know, but he was Puff, you know mm-hmm. what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So, and he sold 7 million records. Mm-hmm. He may be more by now, you know, with the catalog, but he sold 7 million records of No Way Out. He never rapped before.
Right.
So when people see that, they emulate that. So now you got all kind of CEOs rapping, and now you have, I'm a CEO rapping. Mm-hmm. So now it's like, you know, it's flooded with guys who aren't rappers, so you just gotta mime it. You'll find good music still. It's just mm-hmm. you know, more difficult to find.
So Puff effed the game up, is what you're saying, for lyricists?
Nah,
that's not what you said.
That's all you got out of that.
But I would assume that you're inspired by the artists that you sign, also. Or else, why would you sign them if you didn't find them to be an inspiration to you?
Okay.
That works.
You know, for
that
instance,
could have been my answer.
J. Cole, you know, obviously, I would.
Yes,
think.
Very dope.
And J. Electronica.
Very, very dope too.
He said he's up next too. By the way, I saw.
We're waiting. That's like detox.
Let's hope not.
what artists of yours that you signed are you most proud of? Because you're responsible for a lot of careers out here.
You have to say Kanye West, the most successful at this. At this stage of his career and his growth and the progress that he's made is like, it's unbelievable. Mm-hmm. You know, like when he first came in, he wasn't the artist that he is today, you know, but he always aspired to be. From that moment, like from the moment he walked through the door, when he was just the producer, not just the producer, when he was the producer, you know, he had it in his eyes. He was saying stuff like, you know, I am the savior of Chicago. And I was like, what are you even talking about? You don't even have a single. But you know, he proved to be prophetic in that way, you know.
Now, age old hood question, I always say that you put too much pressure on Bleak, because early in his career you said he was going to be the new improved Jay-Z, and he was good, but everybody was waiting on him to be that. So you feel like you might have kind of, you know,
it's just the little brother, like almost the little brother syndrome. He had it more so than anybody, because he really grew up with me. He really grew up in, you know, on the third floor on the same projects from me. So he really had it. He had my shadow on him, you know, the whole time. So whether I said those things or not, it was just there. You know, me saying those things was actually trying to deflect them, you know, trying mm-hmm. to deflect some of it away from him. I wasn't trying to put more on him. It was just like elephant in the room. You walk in the room, like everybody's thinking, yo, that's the next guy. It's just natural.
I never saw you do that with any of your other artists afterwards, so I wonder if that was something you said, you know what, I'm not going to ever do that.
Yeah, he was just, again, he was just one of a kind. Like, he really was from, like, you know, Val, his mother. I used to go in there and, like, Val, open the door and drag him out the house.
Gotcha.
You know, so he was a unique guy.
And he's always been very loyal to you.
Very.
Yeah, like, to this day, still.
Yeah, Bleak is an amazing soul. He's an incredible person.
Oh, I always say people don't,
you know how much pressure people putting on him.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? Yeah.
And Bleak is
you
busy
should be
in the streets.
This, you should do that. Absolutely. You should have $100 million. Mm-hmm. You know, that type of, it's crazy, unrealistic things.
But Bleak gets busy in the streets. He'll come see you too if you say the wrong thing. He'll definitely come see you. Not of recent, but
yo, don't pump Bleak up.
Man. He'll definitely come see you. He'll definitely
don't
come
do
see
that.
You.
Don't
he
do
definitely
that.
Will come see you. Now, also, you spoke of Kanye West. What did you think of Ye's album, the last album, Yeezus?
I liked it.
Like.
Ah, come on, Hov. It's ass time. Out of 10 records, I give him 4.
That's like 40% of a record. That's pretty good, man.
But he's got an amazing catalog, though. Like, he should never put out anything that people even consider is subpar.
Jesus.
Some people love that album. You know, yeah.
It's polarizing, and that's what great art is. It's polarizing. Some people love it. You know, it forced you to have an opinion. Like, you know, at least you're not like wishy-washy about it. You know, it forced you to have an opinion, which is good, and I think it's needed. You know, it's needed because what tends to happen is someone has to experiment and go do it first, and then you know artists will sit back and watch it and be like, okay, I like this, I don't like that, mm-hmm. you know, I like this part, and they'll perfect the methods, and then mm-hmm. you know, and it all pushes the genre forward, mm-hmm. which is good, and that's what he does. He's like a lightning rod for the coach. No, he's actually like the cowboy, you know, he runs over the hill and then, you know, all the Indians hit him with his arrows, and then he comes back like, yo, there's a lot of them over there. And then we go over there and conquer.
What's your reaction whenever you hear him like denounce corporations, being that you are such a corporate entity yourself?
Yeah, I think all, you know, as an individual, I respect that. You know, it's what he chooses to do. You know, me, myself, I can operate in that venue. I can operate, you know, I can walk that line between, you know, putting out great art and, you know, getting paid for my art. I'm not one of those, excuse my language, I ain't one of those that they could talk to and be like, you're an artist, you shouldn't have money. Like, that's the gas. They hit you with that. Mm-hmm. They make mm-hmm. you, yeah, I don't want any money. I want to be a pure artist, and I don't want to have, you know, it's the music business. If that's the case, you should, any artist, not Kanye West, any artist, if, you know, they should just record in their basement and never enter the music business. You know, I just happen to be really good at the music business.
Mm. Do you pay attention to reviews on the album? Does that affect you? Do you read it like, oh, let me see what they said in USA Today?
Or? Yeah, I think reviews have lost a lot of their importance now because of the internet. Like, everyone is experiencing things at the same time. Like, mm-hmm. you can write a review like the guy from USA Today tomorrow. Y'all mm-hmm. both can write the review at the same time. Before, they used to give albums out. That's what happened. That's why the critic became important in the music space, because they got the music first. They would get the music 2 months early, you know, because the magazine had a long lead time. They get it, they sit with it, you know, they review it, they send it out a month ahead of time. You're mm-hmm. reading it, you're looking like, oh, this album's gonna be dope. You don't have the music. Mm-hmm. So you're reading reviews for a month. Right now, the music comes out like this. Right. People are writing a review in a day. First of all, you can't listen to an album and rate it in a day. It's just impossible.
Oh, Magna Carta Classic, 10 minutes after it comes out.
Yeah, it's impossible to even get what every... And the nuances, the all the instrumentation, all the words, what is being, you know, said in the mm-hmm. music, what is about. Like, it's impossible to do that in 24 hours. And when I see that, I'm like, oh... So this is all just bull, you know mm-hmm. what I mean? It's like, okay, so I can't put any weight in it. You know, right. It's good. You review the album, it's great. You like it, fantastic. You don't like it, that's good too. But it doesn't mean anything because, right. you know.
We can all stream it and listen to it and form our own opinion.
That's right. You can have a better review than the guy from the New York Times. Like mm-hmm. I read two reviews. I read the guy from the New York Times, and I read the kid from All Hip Hop. Mm-hmm. They both had like interesting points of view. The guy from All Hip Hop was saying about purgatory, which I feel like sometimes, you know, it's like when you walk that line, it's like, you know, you can't do too much for this side and you do too much for it. It's like mm-hmm. a weird thing. I'm in a weird space, which, you know, I enjoy. But I felt like, you know, his review was just as great as this New York Times writer's review, and this is supposed to be the New York Times.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Right. Same thing to me.
Do you people feel like people consume music too fast? Because you create these amazing moments, but then the moment is fleeting. As soon as you put the album out, it's like people are on it for a few days, then, okay, J. Cole came out, Wale comes out the next week. Wale's out, now Hov's out. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah, it's just, yeah, again, the time that we in, right? We have to figure out, I mean, it's up to the individual to figure out how to slow it down, because, you know, it's just going faster and faster. Everything is moving, you know, quicker. You know, information is going quicker. You know, it's, again, like you said, you know, these great things are fleeting. They're going faster and faster, and it's up to the individual to slow it down and be like, okay, I'm living with this album. This is what I choose to ride to. This is gonna be the soundtrack to my life, or these next couple months. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, right, that's right. That's an individual thing. I'm not gonna let anybody speed up my process. I don't care what's happening out there. That's the great thing about, you know, having ultimate confidence in yourself is it doesn't matter what's happening. I don't care what's happening. I don't care what you're on or this person's on. This is what I like. My life is tailor-made for me.
You ever got to watch your lyrics? Because, you know, things you say, people take literally. Like, I remember watching a press conference at the White House, and they're quoting Jay-Z lyrics about something that you said. You ever be like, man, maybe I shouldn't have said that?
Nah, I'm an artist. I have the creative license to say whatever I feel at that moment. Mm-hmm. You know, I find things funny, like, you know, the Obama thing. Obama said, the irony in that, mm-hmm. the fact that people really believed that and really was like, you lied. I'm like, you believe that?
Oh, yeah. You said hashtag facts only.
Yeah. Yeah, but irony. Mm-hmm. You know, irony is, you got to have some irony in music. That was like, you know. Yeah.
Okay, question as a fan. Is it ever awkward when you're in a room with Nas? Because that Ether Takeover beef with y'all wasn't light.
It was disrespectful.
Yeah, it was a moment in time that was a great moment for hip hop. But for us, you know, we really have a good relationship. We laugh. We don't even, that thing is so far past. And I understand why, you know, even today, that thing is 11 years old, maybe mm-hmm. longer, and like people still fascinated with it, but it's so far removed, it's so far in the background we're not awkward around each other at all.
I say the great thing about it is it didn't destroy either one of your careers. Like sometimes when it did help him at that time. But for both of you, it's not like, okay, now this guy just destroyed me, because that happens sometimes with beef. But you guys both were successful still after that, you even more so.
Yeah, you heard a lot of careers. That's what she wants to say, you know.
Rap is competitive, you know, it's a competitive sport. Each time I went out, I put my career on the line as well, you know, mm-hmm. like that, you know, it could have happened to me, you know.
You heard Prodigy.
And everybody wanted mm-hmm. it to happen, like,
yep.
They did. It was a time where it was like, please let mm-hmm. this guy go away. So, you know, that's just the nature of rap. It's competitive, and, you know, every time you go out there, you're putting your career on the line.
Would you ever do a King of New York album with Nas? Like how you and Ye did Watch the Throne?
Not at this point. You know, like, you know, if any other collaboration album would have to be with Kanye, because, you know, there's chemistry there, and mm-hmm. we already know how we work, and, you know, I don't really have the time to really, like, just figure out those situations and how a person works, and it's hard to do. Mm-hmm. It's hard to do, especially if you're gonna make something great. You know, I mean, the hardest thing ever was, you know, going through those R. Kelly albums. You know, you just never know how the situation's gonna turn out. It's an X factor that you mm-hmm. can't even calculate in your mind that, you mm-hmm. know, can happen at any moment, that you'd be like in the hotel ready to make an announcement. It's like, what? Mm-hmm. What just happened?
Mm-hmm. Ta-ta, get the peppers, bro.
Stupid. We had Jadakiss up here, and we were talking about throw-offs, and Jadakiss was like, you were the biggest throw-off. Like, when it comes to trying to get you on the phone or trying
curve,
to get something,
curve
to you,
he says spin. No, he says spin. That's the word.
Spin.
He
yeah,
he's the master spinner.
The master spinner.
Spin people.
It was like, when it comes to getting Hov on the phone, he said, Hov will call you the day after. Like, yo, I just got back from in the country, man. I just got your text. You still need me?
Sounds like me.
But he said, at least
like
you
real talk to me.
At least you do answer his calls, though. You know, that's important.
Yeah. Now, was it Kiss can get me on the phone anytime?
Was it nerve-wracking, like, doing this whole new deal with Samsung that had never been done before, and then there were, like, some glitches people were saying and trying to get the app right and get the album, because it's the first time it's been done?
Yeah, that, again, in that instance, I was the cowboy running over the hill. You know, anytime that you try to do something different, and you should always try to, you know, push forward, and whatever you're doing is going to be problems because it's never been done before. So you can't anticipate all the things that's going to happen. The thing that happened with Samsung is a real thing. It was 20 million hits to the app. I'm not saying 20 million people hit that, but, you know,
right.
a million
over
people,
over.
We went over a million, right? A million, say, a million three mm-hmm. or whatever. It was trying, right? And you couldn't get through, you know, you hit it 20 times. So that's 20 million hits. It was 20 million hits for the app, and it broke. No one's expecting. There's no way in the world for you to calculate 20 million right. hits. It's not even a number that you can fathom.
Mm-hmm.
It's 20 times the amount we thought was gonna happen. Mm-hmm. Right. You know. So you can't even like prepare service for that. It's very difficult.
So in a way, it's a great problem to have because that's a whole bunch.
It's not a great problem because you want like the fan to get that experience. The people that waited and downloaded it, you want them to have that experience right away. Mm-hmm. That's the only thing. It was like, you know, a little disheartening to me that I was like, man, because imagine that. Like, I can't even imagine like waiting for, you know, Rakim's album at 12 o'clock and I couldn't get it. And I downloaded
on
the 24th.
I did everything right.
24th, I downloaded my app. I set it. I watched the clock countdown. Mm-hmm. And at 12 o'clock, I couldn't get it. You know, so for me, that's you know, that's not cool. That's a loss. And, you know, that has to get better. But again, someone else is going to figure out. The next person is going to now know, you know, how to go into it better. Which is cool, and that's my job. You know, I took the hit for that.
I saw you tweet Ab Soul yesterday, and you said you was a fan of the whole movement. I guess the whole Black hippie movement with Kendrick Lamar and everybody. Like, who keeps you in tune with that kind of stuff? Because people think you don't live on this planet, so that you don't know what's going on.
Yeah,
on
like an alien or something. I like music. I really like music, and when people make good music, I'll find it. You know, I don't listen to everything. I don't really care to listen to everything. I actually don't want to listen to anything. So if it makes it to me, that means you know, you're doing something right.
You hear a lot of New York artists complain about the state of New York hip hop. You are a New York artist. Over the years, have you looked at New York and said, what's going on with our city musically?
Yeah, but that's just a thing. That's just, you know, it's cool. It's a regional thing. Like, that's the way music moves. You know, it was out west, mm-hmm. out down south, or, you know, whatever. That's the way it moves. The whole thing is complaining does nothing. Make music. Make some great music, and that's the end of it. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't even know what to say. You know,
Hov's like, I'm too busy winning the war here. They complain. I don't.
Yeah, no, I just don't care about it. It's like, it's almost like a loser's mentality. It's like, right. Everyone's so spoiled. Like, right. It's like, you know, he won't let me shine. I even heard someone say like, yo, why is Jay won't let Kanye? I'm like, let Kanye. Kanye's Kanye. He's gonna do what he does. That's a loser's mentality. When we were gonna sound like one of those rappers. When we were coming up, you know, I mean, it was, my albums came out with Outkast, Lauren, Q-Tip, mm-hmm. all of them in 1 week. Mm-hmm. You know, everybody did good. Mm-hmm. You know, look at the chart now. It's Wale, number one. This is like a shameless plug. Yeah. Rock Nation, managed artist, J. Cole, mm-hmm. which will probably go to number one next week again. No, for the first time ever, but he'll go to number one. Rock Nation, and it's Kanye. Everyone's flourishing. You know, you got to be out. You got to be able to compete. Still mm-hmm. sharp and still. You got to get out there and you got to earn your spot. It's not given. It's such a spoiled brat loser's mentality. Mm-hmm. That's it's annoying.
Is there anybody new from New York that you feel?
You know, they're making noise. They haven't reached that level yet to really be like
shouting them out.
Yeah, but that's
real though.
But you know, it's good. But it's again, it's not really about. It's not a regional. It's not a regional thing. Unless it's like five of them. That's the only way you can make it live. And that's the only way you can make hip hop live in your region. Is that you have four or five people doing it at one time. Mm-hmm. You have one person flourishing, it's going to be, it is what it is.
Now, has fatherhood changed you at all? As far as lyric?
I mean, absolutely. Mm-hmm. You know.
How is Jay as a dad?
I hope I'm great, but mm-hmm. I'm learning. Again, it's a new thing for me. Mm-hmm. And I guess change me in a way that, I mean, just knowing what's important. Mm. Knowing the things that are important is, you know. But I had a pretty good sense of that. Mm-hmm. But it just reaffirmed all the things that I believed I knew.
Now, how were you with you know, and the reason I'm asking, because I'm going through it now. So how were you with, like, every 2 hours the baby getting up and changing pampers and similar?
Nah, I got an army, man. It's
like, you ain't do none of that?
I mean, of course, but come on, man. It's hard, man. It's difficult.
Can I ask you a question? The first thing I thought when I heard about
I'm here to be asked questions.
The Rock Nation Sports. Okay, that you...
Okay, I didn't want to get you on your thing. I know that
no,
one.
Don't get started.
Okay, go.
Yeah, let's all fall back.
Yeah.
Do you have to give up your seats at the Barclays Center?
No.
So you told y'all that in the open letter.
That part was true.
Okay, I just want to make sure.
No, of course not.
All right, those seats. Yeah. Because you know
I'm
what?
I'm still on the building. I'm still.
No, because I used to be able to go to the Nets games and sit in your seats because
yeah,
you never used to go
good.
To those.
Don't worry about it. This is a selfish
question.
Yeah, this is
selfish.
You just want to make sure you're good. What kind of question is that?
This question is loaded. Don't worry, you're good.
I'm
going to write you in 4 games a year.
Okay.
Can we clear up another Power 105 bet? These two were arguing about who knew Jay the longest.
Who too?
Angela Yee and DJ Envy.
Okay.
Nah, I definitely knew Envy before Angie.
I told him I knew him before Mary J. Blige was on the hook to Can't Knock the Hustle when it was that wax.
Yeah. No, I think I knew
he said
longer.
She used to help y'all bag up in an apartment in Brooklyn.
I think I might have known you longer than Envy, though. I might have. Because, I should have bought that tape in. Because when I first met you, you were giving out cassettes of Dead President's single.
Yeah,
at
that
the
was
Palladium.
Too late by then. Yeah, I had to record the album first.
Mm-hmm. It was a single, though. It wasn't a whole album. It was just a
cassette. But I'm saying I had to record it. He was there first. I'm going to just give him that.
Okay,
all right. Yeah,
well, shortly thereafter.
That's when he was DJ Shrimp.
I was definitely DJ Shrimp at that time.
You knew him before me. I didn't know.
Another hood question. Do you ever feel sorry for Damon Dash, man, whenever you hear about, like, his financial problems and things like that?
Dame's a hustler. Dame will figure it out. Like, Dame, very smart guy, you know? So he'll figure it out.
He was definitely playing your album and on Instagram.
Yeah,
like,
did you see that video?
Sweet.
Nah, I didn't see it.
He was in the barbershop, bobbing his head crazy to it. He said he liked it. He said he felt like he was a part of that. And he knows you're telling the truth.
Mm-hmm. I feel like, you know, what people got to understand, I mean, nothing going to change the way I feel about Damon. You know, no matter, not no time or space, no separation or anything. You know, I got love for Damon Dash the same way as I did before. I don't know if we can be around each other in that way because times have changed. And, you know, he may be a totally different person. I know I'm a different person. Mm-hmm. But nothing can erase that era and the things that we, you know, those times and those memories and those fights that we had, you know, to get Rockefeller where it was. It just is what it is. Nothing's going to change that. You know, there'll be some, you know, minor things in the middle that are getting away, but those things go away and then the relationship remains and those memories remain. We did something great. We built something that is going to be here forever, that is going to be talked about forever. So, you know, There will always be, you know, love there.
What was your worst signee at Rockefeller? The worst person like me that just didn't see Rockefeller.
I'm sorry.
No.
I wouldn't say Mill. Mill album, you should listen to it. It wasn't that
I did.
Bad. It's good.
Nah.
You had a reggaeton era as well.
Yeah.
Was you really responsible for that? Or was that more than?
I'm not gonna put nobody on. I'll take that one.
That didn't seem like home for the team.
The
old dirty signing didn't seem like home.
Yeah, I'm gonna take that. I'm gonna take all that for the team. Then what was the
worst signing? Yeah.
He don't want to throw.
You was talking about
in.
How Emil was your worst.
There's somebody that didn't fit.
I don't. Let me think about that.
And what was the artist you passed upon that you could have had that you didn't sign and
passed on? I don't know.
Was there any artist you passed on?
I don't know if we passed on anybody that could have, that was great. Because we signed everybody that don't.
Yeah, at the end, y'all signed everybody. Y'all signed everybody.
Tax write off.
Yeah. Oh my God. That's not even like a real thing, but it's funny.
When you look at the game. And, you know, you look at where you're at now and you look at the peers you came up with in the 90s. Did you say to yourself, I knew I was going to be here and I knew those guys were going to be there? And I'm asking you that because I want to know what you think of the game now and who's going to be here 10 years from now.
Yeah, I absolutely, because I wanted to be here, mm-hmm. You know, and I saw a lot of people let opportunities go. I was like, oh, that he's not going to be around. Why aren't you doing this? If I had that, I'd be doing this. And I think about it in those terms. I think about it not outside of what we do. I think about it just in strategic moves. Mm-hmm. When you have it and you're about to have it and, you know, what happens. And, you know, I remember one time walking in the studio and it was like a small gap. And Bleak Beans, everybody was in there, and I was like, man, I'm telling you, man, y'all better, y'all got a chance right now, just flood it, put out a lot of music, mm-hmm. because 50 Cent is coming, mm-hmm. and, you know, 4 months later, in the club hit, and it was over, and right. It was just like, okay, now everybody got to sit on the sidelines and wait this tidal wave out, mm-hmm. so, like, just seeing things like that. Mm-hmm.
I remember when you wanted to sign Wayne, before Wayne really took off.
Yeah.
So you have that kind of vision. So who do you see now that's going to be here 10 years from now? Have they reached the level to get a shout out?
Yeah. These people that I'm about to mention definitely reached the level. I mean, obviously, J. Cole,
Kendrick.
Drake, absolutely. Kendrick as well. I think just on he's talented, very talented, but just on sheer will and wanting it, Wale is going to be here as well. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to stretch. I'm sure it's other people, right. But I just want, you know. Just...
Now, you mentioned Lil Wayne. I know that you guys were this close to signing Wayne. What happened with that deal? Because, I mean, they got to, I mean, Wayne was damn near saying he was Rockefeller, and then it just went left.
The truth is, it's the first time I ever said told this truth. The mm-hmm. truth is, after I had I had a meeting with Wayne, I had a relationship with Baby, so, I used to go to New Orleans. I would hang out with him. He had me in the purple little whatever that car was. Remember them purple little cars?
Prowler
going down the street. Mm-hmm. No top. People trying to jump in the car. So I felt it was only right to call him. Mm-hmm. I called them out of respect. Like, yo, I was talking to Wayne. Just letting you know. Boom, boom, boom. So after that, I think we received a letter at our office for like torturous interference.
Whoa.
And I was like, whoa.
Is it sports? They do that?
It was like, whoa. And it just all went from there. But, I think I would rather, lose that situation and do the right thing than the opposite. Because I think I could have signed him. I could have signed him and then told him after. But, I did the right thing and, I'm cool with that decision.
How close were you to really spanking Wayne when he threw that shot at the wife?
It was all right. It's part of the sport and the competition. I didn't take it serious. I didn't view it as a threat. I thought it was just a flip of a line that I said because I said I ain't got my wifey money. I wasn't really speaking to him, but I guess he's holding the flag, so he did the right thing for his camp. And but I didn't take it as a real threat. I took it as a flip of a line.
Mm. Now another hood question. People always say, if Biggie hadn't passed, Hov wouldn't be here. I know you've heard that before.
That's ridiculous, right? That's. I mean, I was here while Biggie was here.
Some people say you made your best material when he was here.
I think just us again, like I said, still sharp and still. The way we were working and the album that we were going to create together would have only made me better, as a lyricist. So, and it's just like that's God's plan. It's God's plan. It's just like saying Biggie wouldn't be here if Rakim had been on the Faith remix, or like you say, like it's like you can make up any scenario in your mind why a person shouldn't be here, or a person wouldn't attain the success that they have. But I personally don't believe anybody could stop me. I really that's just how I believe. And it was gonna be, I was coming. I was destined to be here, and it just is what it is.
Why people can't give you that though? Why is it you got to be something else? Oh, Big. If Big was here, it wouldn't be like that. He's an Illuminati. Why can't you just be good and successful nowadays?
That's a very philosophical question because I can only assume, right? I can only assume because I don't know the answer to that, except that, sometimes people's success, make people feel, instead of saying, wow, that person's successful and I'm inspired. Well, some people are. Some people are like, that person's successful. I'm a strive and I'm gonna be exactly where they are. And some people are just like, they got the reverse attitude, like their success means my failure. So I'd hate that success. So I have to make some kind of explanation of why they're here and why they shouldn't be here and why they wouldn't be here if this person was here. Who thinks like that?
It's not just black people.
That is. That's more so in hip hop, black culture.
If you take that long to think about someone why they shouldn't be here, then you're good, mm-hmm. and you should be doing something with that intelligence. Right? Mm-hmm. You should apply that intelligence to something else.
Absolutely.
Right? If you like, that person would be here. You're like a scientist. Mm-hmm. You should really be figuring out some shit that can help us in the world.
Now, for you moving into sports management, does it feel to you like a lot of people don't want you to succeed? Because they're saying that's a really tough business. There's a lot of agents that feel like, well, what does Jay-Z know about sports management? And he hasn't done this and he hasn't done that.
Yeah, but they have that thing that, you know, that belief that you can only do one thing. You know, we don't have that. We're not inflicted with that disease. Mm-hmm. You know, I can walk and chew gum. You know, it's insane to even say that. What does he know about sports? It's like everything, more than you. You know, and as far as business, those guys have been sitting around just doing the typical thing, right? They mm-hmm. get an artist, right? However they acquire the artist. I don't want to do that to them. However they acquire the artist, the athlete, they get them, and then they knock on the same doors. They go to Nike, you know, they do the contract, and they sit back. They don't do anything else. Right. So they've been sitting around for 20, 30 years just not doing anything.
Same formula.
Yeah, so me coming, that's a problem for them, because now they have to go to work. Now they have to wake up. Now they have to do things. So they don't want me to. They don't want me around, because now they have to do something for these athletes. And my whole thing is, you know, for the most part, I'm going to do more for the athlete than they're going to do for me. And at the end of the day, mm-hmm. I do this because it's an extension of the bigger goal. The bigger goal is to, you know, for all artists, to get their just due, mm-hmm. not the, you know, these guys, not to get half-ass agents or people who rob them or people don't care about their finances. They don't even care about that. That's why those guys go broke in 4 years. It's like a shame. Right. Like, it's like, mm-hmm. it's the average is 3 to 4 years. We're talking about guys who signing for $90 million, $86 million are broke in 4 years. That's terrible mm-hmm. money management. Mm-hmm. But because these guys don't care. They just taking the whatever is going to get them a check, and they're not even worrying about all that. We're doing all of that. We almost do that better. We're almost a better money management firm mm-hmm. and then agents.
Yeah, that's been an ongoing problem with sports, with athletes going broke. NFL, yeah,
that's their representation, not caring about
artists
anything
as well,
but their check.
But then you have people who will say, what does Jay-Z know about money?
Yeah, right.
Nobody's gonna say that.
Is that something you do for all your artists as well? Is kind of put them through some type of financial training and set them up in that way?
Yes. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, Master P was here. He said he would never do the sports agency thing again because athletes are too spoiled, and there's really no money in the thing. But I mean, I hear you saying it's a bigger purpose. You want to teach people how to keep their money, basically.
Absolutely.
Because it'll make you money.
Yeah. Not that it's all like this, you know, philanthropic thing. It's a business as well. Mm-hmm. But again, you know, mm-hmm. I'm going to contribute just as much or more to an athlete's career than they can ever give me. Mm-hmm. You know.
Now, what made you decide to get up out of Def Jam as president when you went over there to be president? And then I kind of felt like maybe you felt it just wasn't right for you to be working.
You had to make room for Packers.
Yeah, Packers is coming up.
Packers is coming.
You know, more so, I wanted to do more. I wanted to do more things than just than to make music. You know, and in that position, I was in a position to foster artists' careers and just make money. And you know, I was knocking on the doors of all the powers that be, and was like, "Yo, you understand? Like, I can do more." Before this, you know, Beats by Dre and all that, I could do things like that. Mm-hmm. You know, I can identify companies. We'll go get Billionaire Boys Club. This is before it was part of, you know, our thing. You know, I was like, we can get Billionaires Boys Club, and you know, it's hot right now, and then all the artists want to wear it anyway. We let the artists wear it. You know, I'm giving these guys like these I'm giving these guys these simple business plans. You know, and it was just like, no, just
bring some hits.
Yeah. And I was like, well, then mm-hmm. I gotta move on then, because you know, my time now is being wasted.
Now, you know, if you walk mm-hmm. around with that chain all day, people are gonna be asking you, what's the science? What's today's mathematics?
Yeah.
All day
this
long.
By the way, this isn't even my chain. I stole it from somebody. Yeah, I tell y'all who got off camera.
Uh-oh.
You're stealing chains now? Is it a world star?
Not really stealing.
Does it mean anything to you, though?
Yeah, a little bit.
I'm with you. I don't like the conversation either. It's like, I call myself the God because I feel like it sometimes. I study a little lessons, but I'm not into all, you know.
Yeah. Religion is like a personal computer, you know. You let people in if you want to.
Uh-oh.
It is. It truly is. You know how people look at your computer, you're like, yo, this is a personal computer.
That's what everybody says, oh, Jay-Z, with the new album. They're like, oh, Jay-Z has such a God complex. I'm like, a man can't reference God? Like, Genesis 1:26 says God created man in his image, so I can't reference myself.
Absolutely.
A little bit every now and then is God.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. We are all gods. Mm-hmm.
Besides sports, what else do you watch on TV? Do you watch any of these reality shows?
They don't think you're human.
Yeah, but no.
I know you used to watch Sex in the City when that used to come on.
Yeah,
but.
And I still watch HBO. I watch HBO on ESPN.
You watch TV?
Yeah.
He definitely watches sports.
Yeah.
Obviously.
Yeah.
HBO, huh?
Like, you gotta watch Nickelodeon.
I don't watch Nickelodeon.
You don't watch Girls or
it's a little Kirby Baby Einstein.
A little Baby Einstein.
That's always on.
Yeah, Baby Einstein in the music. Yeah.
Yeah.
Have you ever had to kick anybody out the room because they approached you about doing a reality show with you and the family?
Nah, that's never happened.
No one's gonna ask you that.
No one ever getting that close to me. Anyone with those type of questions have.
Tata, get the pepper spray. Ask me about some
Anyone
reality
with
show.
Those type of questions to get vetted. There's no way. There's 18 layers before that happens.
Now, how did you link back up with Timbaland? Because it seems like y'all were apart for a minute, and then all of a sudden it seems like you got him back smoking again.
Yeah, Tim, me and Tim have always been great, but we've never been able to, like, do more than, like, one record together.
He's living in your house right now.
We've been together for since the year started,
right.
You know, basically. But we've only been able to create, like, in small time frames. Mm-hmm. Like, we'd do Big Pimpin', that was it.
Right.
You know, it was just, like, a personality thing. It wasn't really clicking. But we always had like genuine love for each other, but mm-hmm. it just wasn't right. And then, you know, finally, when he came back this time,
he was a little humbler. He was humble.
He was just a
because he changed. Timbaland changed.
More mature. Yeah,
yeah, he
actually was like a different person. Mm-hmm. It was like I was looking at a different person.
Absolutely.
The way he just, you know, was like his conversation and everything. Mm-hmm. I was like, oh, Tim's ready.
Yeah,
Tim.
And what about Just Blaze?
What?
How's Just Blaze? Because we heard that you was working with some stuff with him, and we just haven't heard anything as of yet.
He said he wants to know why Just Blaze isn't on the new album. That's what he said.
Yeah, we just didn't find that zone. And plus, the thing with Just Blaze and I is we really have like records that people really care about. So many you don't know the PSA. So when we're trying to make music, we're trying to beat that.
Right.
So it's not like a blank sheet when he walks in the room. You know, with Timbaland, we make Big Pimpin' and Dirt Up Your Shoulders. We can always, you know, those are hit records. We can always find a zone. You know, these are records that are like the foundation of to my career. So we're in there trying to beat those, and that's gonna be hard. That's hard for us to do, and that takes time. Mm-hmm. You know, and I'm not in one place, and he's certainly not focused as well. He's doing his DJ thing, and you know whatever he's working on. And so it's hard to. We need time.
So just get focused out there, Just.
Have you ever thought?
Me too. I'm not just putting it on him. Mm-hmm. You know, we both need to focus if we're gonna do something that's gonna stand up to those records.
Have you ever thought about doing any charity and doing like a Rockefeller reunion? Like the state property.
You should do a charity.
Beanie Siegel, free.
I'm not really into, like, you know, those. Truly, the past is the past. You know, we'll do shows together like Philly and last year and things like that where it makes sense, but I'm not really trying to recreate the past. You know, it can never be what it was, you know, and that time was that time and moment. It was special. That never works. I don't know if it's ever worked. I'm trying to think, and it's not really coming to me now. I don't know if it ever works when you try to recreate something. It's just like, you know, people just start looking like a little slower. You know what I mean? The moves ain't the same. You know what I'm saying? Like, you're doing the same moves, but they're a little, you know, it's like.
Also, Justin Timberlake, he did an interview and said he asked you to be on the record a while ago, and you kind of was like, nah, it's not that time.
Next album.
And he was like, you know, I'll never use Jay again. And then, maybe a couple months later, we heard, you know, his record with you on it. So did y'all have to talk about that first? Like, you play me. Like, you know. Well,
nah,
I was just.
Nah, it's you know, everyone has to respect everyone's choice and time. Mm-hmm. You know, it just wasn't the time for us to link up yet. Mm-hmm. You know, and, you know, the time is just now. Mm-hmm. But it was no real deep conversation about it. We just was in the studio and we just made some music.
Another hood question. Young Chris, your former artist, how much did he influence you? Because a lot of people say you took his style or he took yours.
I made with all due respect to Chris, he was an amazing artist. You know, he did amazing things. But, you know, the music is there. You know, I made records before Chris and after him. Mm-hmm. You know, so I don't even know how to answer that. it's like the weirdest thing in the world to me. Like, I don't know.
You've heard this stuff before, though.
Of course. Okay, no. I've heard it.
Charlie's just over here.
I don't want to get fired.
I've never heard that before.
It's just weird to me. It's like, really? Like,
I'll get pulled in the office by the PD. Why did you ask Jay that? I'm like, it's been on the internet for years.
Now, have you heard Robert De Niro back yet? Because he was trying to reach you. I don't know if you saw that.
Who? Oh, Robert De Niro.
No, I haven't.
He's mad. He's pretty mad, too.
How do you duck Robert De Niro?
How do you get to the point in your life where you can curb Robert De Niro? Like, it's Robert De Niro.
I treat people based on who they are. In you know who they really are, like not the name, not Robert De Niro, like you know who you are as a person, and that's just it's,
so he's
it,
does,
it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter who you are. Everyone has to be respectful, and everyone has to be you know a human being, and that's you know no one's above. No one's above. You know.
The spin,
the curve. Yeah.
Respect the fact that I am Hove. It's 18 layers to this. You got 18 people to talk to before you can talk to me.
No, not like not in that way. Yeah.
Curve,
but yes. But I'm not saying that in that way. It's just you know we all human beings and we all have to be respectful to one another, and that's just the end of it. And that's how I carry it with anybody.
Now, is there any rumor that you've ever heard that made you be like, all right, this is just weird?
All of them.
All the time. Well, yeah. Which ones? What do you want to start with?
Like the, when they said Beyonce didn't really have the baby.
That's a good one. Yeah. That's probably the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. And the fact that people were really like running with that and running up with it and had follow-up stories. Because at first I thought it was a you know, one of those get press things. Like, you know, like, let's run with this for press. Mm-hmm. Then I was slowly like, oh, y'all believe this.
Right.
It started going so far like, oh, y'all really believe this, and that's messed up because like it, you know the time where you're supposed to be most joyous, you got life and the whole thing, it's supposed to be a joyous time for you to have to like deal with that, whether you say you care about it or not is annoying, and you shouldn't have to really deal with that as a human being, but you know that's the position that we're in, you know. Don't feel sorry.
how do you keep from responding to a certain thing, though? Because everybody always says, okay, I got a Jay-Z the situation and not say nothing. Like, you always seem to keep your cool and not respond to the BS that's out there.
It doesn't matter. It really doesn't matter because, you know, when you're not in control of the outcome, it don't matter what I say. It don't matter how many times. It don't matter, again, it don't matter how many times you say that, you know, Beyonce is really pregnant.
Right.
People gonna believe what they wanna believe anyway. So, I mean, why waste my time?
And sometimes you respond to something that brings way more attention to it, too.
That, too. And it's just, it goes into another space, and then you're just like, are y'all not listening to me?
Right. But then you'll have somebody that'll say to you, Jay-Z, how do you know Beyonce's pregnant?
Yeah. Check.
Well, the album's in stores right now. We appreciate you stopping through. Now, some of the lyrics on the album, this is something that the intern pulled up, and she was reading.
Oh, don't try to put it on somebody else, Envy.
Now, I'm going to read it. She was talking about Beyonce cheating on you. And I guess in your lyrics you say, keep cheating on me, what I do, I took you back for weeks.
All right, he's about to get fired. I don't know nothing about turning my back on
no,
this.
That record is about fame. See, that's what I mean.
That's what we're asking.
Yeah, I know, it's all good.
I don't want to get fired. Don't pepper spray.
That's why DJ Shrimp is asking.
I want to get fired or pepper spray. Emery just turned around, just making sure.
That song is about fame, you know, and it's about the way, you know, fame is fleeting, you know, the Holy Grail, meaning like you chase this thing and these bright lights and these cameras and then you look back, you want everything and then you end up with nothing. Mm-hmm. So at some point you have to stop yourself, you know, so that whole first verse is me complaining about it, you know, the fame, she cheats on me, you know, she hangs out with Kanye and Drake and J. Cole and... I took her back, you know, so when it's my turn, I take her back. So the whole thing is about fame. And then the second verse is about, you know, who the f*** fame. You know, mm-hmm. It's not really about anything. So I start to rationalize, and it says people dying back where I was from. Like, putting it in real perspective. Right. Like, I don't care about this. I mean, people got real life problems where I live, mm-hmm. where I grew up. People are dying and getting shot daily. You know, like 40-something people got shot in Chicago. What I care about being on Envy Show.
Right. No, it's a good show.
But do you have these conversations?
You know what I'm saying? But I'm saying, like, let's put it all in perspective. Right. You know, I got a good life. Mm-hmm. You know, I got a great life. You know, whatever comes with it, even ridiculous rumors about anything.
It's nothing
it's
compared
nothing.
To.
It's nothing compared right. to what, you know, where I've been.
Is it crazy for you going back to Bed-Stuy and to Marcy and everything and seeing how different the neighborhood is now?
Yeah, it's like condos. It was like these huge condos.
It's
like condos right across the street. I got a great story for that. I don't forget what album it was. Maybe 2 or 3 albums ago. The guy who does the sample came in the studio and he was like, yeah, I bought a great condo right across the street from Marcy Project. And I was like, I don't get it. You know, he was like, up really, he had a great job, great position, mm-hmm. he was making good money, and I was like, why does he live across the street from Marcy Project? Mm-hmm. And then he was like, he came back a couple days later, he was like, yeah, we moved. He said at nighttime, you know, his wife was pregnant, he said at nighttime we heard pow, pow. He said, I thought it was firecrackers, and it kept going pow, pow. He went and seen the apartment in the daytime.
Right. Mm.
So that's a bit of advice for everybody.
I've been
the apartment at day.
You have to ride through at night, and when it's hot out, that's when you really can tell what a neighborhood is like. Because I'm looking at Bed-Stuy, and everything is like over $1 million, and it never used to be. Like, it's crazy.
Now, my final question: what you said about fame? Do you ever have that conversation with Ye? Like, Ye, it's just the paparazzi. That's not a real problem.
Yeah, all the time.
Okay, that's the answer.
Yeah. When you seen him hit his head on that stop sign, did you laugh? I'm just curious. Did you laugh when the first time you seen it?
I chuckled.
All right.
When you saw Charlamagne getting chased outside the building, did you laugh?
That was pretty funny.
I laughed really hard.
Listen, you gotta see the other video. It's another video.
There's no other video.
No. Some cats tried to get me in the store, and it's a surveillance video, like some
old
dog.
No, one cat, not some cat.
One guy.
The one thing I liked about it, I mean, because you can't help that. If somebody just run up on you and knock you inside your head, you know what I mean?
I'm shocked. I'm startled.
Yeah,
I'm like.
Yeah, no, that is what it is. That can happen to anybody. The way you. But
not you.
You saw it coming.
He seen it.
That was a good. That was the thing I saw. I was like, okay, that was you know, little nuances of your personality. You saw it coming. You knew that thing was coming.
He was jetting.
You know what gave it away though?
What?
The camera.
Yeah.
It's the World Star era. Like right. Nothing's good is gonna come of this situation.
Right.
Like, I'm getting out of here. I'm not letting these guys plan go through. They might have peed on me or something. I don't know.
My goodness. Ladies and gentlemen, Jay-Z. It's the Breakfast Club.
The Breakfast Club, every weekday morning. Tune in.